Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to Fenway Park.
It's another night that reminds us how fortunate we are to live in this city.
Welcome to Foxborough's Gillette Stadium.
There's a drive to deep right center. This may be gone. Brad Bay back there watching. Oh, good! And with him.
Gets it out deep and have a check.
Behind the net to Sanderson, and Orr! Bobby Orr! Orr to the Boston Bruins! And Orr from Stanley Cup!
There it goes, a long drive, if it stays fair, home run!
And now there's a steal by Burr! Underneath the DJ, lays it in! White has 1 second left! What a play by Burr!
Being a sports fan in Boston for a very long time was defined by heartbreak and heartache.
When I was a kid, no one was talking about the Patriots. The Patriots weren't discussed.
Watching WBZ TV Boston. Coming up next on WBZ News 4.
Sold. Tonight, the Patriots have a new owner. The New England Patriots are staying right here in Massachusetts.
He understands what a football team means to this community. He'll become the next owner of the New England Patriots, Robert Kraft.
My objective in doing this is to help bring a championship to New England. We didn't do this to be a doormat for any of the teams. We do like to win. We think everything is in place to make that happen.
This is a great day for the New England Patriots. I'm very excited to introduce to you our new head coach, Bill Belichick.
Well, I think it was the best decision I've made since I've owned the franchise.
I'm thrilled to be part of this organization and to be able to have the opportunity to lead this team.
I like him a lot, and I believe he's the most capable person at this point in time to help us win next year.
That's all I really am about, trying to win football games.
What do you think makes a good ball player?
I'd like to introduce my starting quarterback from this past season, Tom Brady. If any colleges or coaches are interested in seeing more of Tom, we have a whole list of past plays that you can sort of look over the 10-game period of last season.
Play action, Brady, look out!
Under fire, under pressure.
He got away from one, got away from another. He goes that way, and he's got Terrell. In the open field, David Terrell, inside the 20. Michigan! Touchdown!
Boy, that was a nifty bit of footwork by Tom Brady, who didn't go down.
The good thing with Brady is he's always had leadership. Like, even he always, you hear the people, hey, bet on yourself. Tom Brady always believed in himself.
Brady to throw. Down the middle he goes to his fullback, Shea, and he's got a first down at the 40-yard line.
When it was time, Tom Brady
did it again.
Second down and 8. Brady fires. Terrell's got another one. Down to the 20.
Tom Brady in his final appearance, the Michigan quarterback. There's what he's done so far.
Made a move at the 15, the 10. He's in again. Overtime at the 66th FedEx Orange Bowl. It's Michigan on offense first at the 25-yard line. Brady, nice play fake. Fires across the middle. His tight end's got it. Sean Thompson, touchdown. Just like that, Michigan wins in overtime. And a career high for Tom Brady in both yardage and now touchdown. His fourth touchdown pass of the night.
It's just a masterpiece. It's a thing of beauty. It's clutchness beyond comprehension.
This is the draft report on you. Basically, it goes poor build, skinny, lacks great physical stature and strength.
His 40 time and that vertical jump. In 32 years of doing this, we talked about 576 quarterbacks. He was number 576. Lacks mobility and ability to avoid the rush. Lacks a really strong arm. Can't drive the ball downfield. Does not throw a really tight spiral.
System type player who can get exposed if forced to add lift.
And gets knocked down easily.
That kind of gets me fired up because I'm thinking, you know, what the hell do these people know?
Means they missed the most important part. Heart. They didn't understand what drives somebody.
We're in the draft room. It was the fifth round.
18 seconds.
Remember, Belichick walking up to the board and said, wow, this Brady's still on the board.
And with the 199th overall pick, they selected a skinny quarterback from Michigan named Tom Brady.
This skinny beanpole of a young man walked over to me and said, hi, Mr. Kraft, I want to introduce myself. I'm Tom Brady. And I said, I know who you are. You're our six-round draft choice. And I always remember he looked me like a laser eye to eye, and he said, that's right, and I'm the best decision this organization has ever made.
Drew Bledsoe, now in his ninth year, just 500 yards away from joining that 30,000-yard club out of Washington State.
He was right in my hip pocket all the time trying to learn, so I figured he'd be like a 10, 11-year backup. That's kind of what I figured he would.
Zeroes in on Bledsoe. They've not sacked Bledsoe today, and that's quite in contrast to last year when they sacked him. Bledsoe, gonna run it, needs 10 yards. Oh, he hit. Oh, my.
Bledsoe's injuries will thrust second-year backup Tom Brady into the starting role.
A lot of people don't believe in you. It was obvious by, you know, six other quarterbacks taken and 198 other picks. And I always felt, you know what, once I get my shot, I'm going to be ready. I'm going to really take advantage of that.
It was a coming out party for the comeback kid.
The snap to Brady. Looks, stands, starts to run with it. He's got the five and a half. Touchdown! Tom Brady spikes the ball and goes wild on the 45-yard field goal attempt coming up. Snap, ball down. Kickoff on the way. And it is good.
After the Tuck Rule, he started becoming a legend. In overtime, he went 8 for 8, including a fourth down conversion.
It is going to be a chippy field goal. The crowd will tell you whether he makes it or not. Set to go. Snap. Ball down. Kick is up. Take the end!
Super Bowl 36, coming up between the St. Louis Rams and the New England Patriots.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, greetings to the United States. Here are the American Football Conference champions, the New England Patriots.
Mahomes back to throw, and here's the flex by Mike Vrabel. The pass is intercepted. Picked off by Tyrone. 30, 25, 20, 15, touchdown, touchdown. Tyrone picks it off and takes it to the house.
Man, that first Super Bowl against the Rams, the greatest show. You talking about a mismatch.
Brady drops back to throw. Looks. Fires right. Touchdown!
When Tom told Robert Kraft as a six-rounder, this is going to be your best draft pick ever, Tom Brady helped create the Patriot way. It was inside of him.
If we go back to that first Super Bowl.
Now with no timeouts, I think it could be.
Remember how John Madden was saying, go to overtime, play for overtime.
You have to play for overtime now. I don't think you want to force anything here. You don't want to do anything. You have no timeouts and you're back up.
Brady and Belichick thought differently.
He has been very, very impressive with his calmness.
Brady again.
And it's Troy Brown, and he gets out of bounds, and they might be in Vinatieri's range.
That team, they won 11 games that year when they were 0-2 and 5-11 the year before. Then they won the Super Bowl.
Vinatieri in range. And it's right down the pipe.
The Patriots have won the Super Bowl 36. Unbelievable.
Sunday, the Patriots made the real Peyton Manning look like a third-string quarterback.
The end zone intercepted in the end zone.
Belichick, what they do.
That when you come to play, you better be ready to come play against the Tom Brady that you all know and hate.
The Patriots looking for a second Super Bowl title in 3 years from 41 yards. Looks good. Patriots claim their second Super Bowl championship in 3 years. We've talked about it in this era of free agency and player movement. That's as close to a dynasty as you're ever going to find.
And this is a nightmare for the Red Sox and their fans, looking at a 3-0 deficit in this series. And the hits just keep sailing out of this batter's box. One guy after another swinging from his heels for the Yankees.
The Yankees have a stranglehold on this series. They have a three-game lead.
How do you come back from this? Being embarrassed on your home diamond by your most hated rival.
Interesting to me just exactly what's said in that Boston clubhouse after the game tonight.
And by day's end, poor Ben had become one of God's most pathetic creatures, a Red Sox fan. And that's where the story begins.
Careful, kid. They'll break your heart.
I mean, I know you're from Mass, and I know you grew up a Red Sox fan, but don't count the Sox out. It hasn't happened in the history of baseball, but don't let us win today. That's all I'm trying to say. Don't let us win today and give them Pedro tomorrow and then shilling game six, and then anything can happen in game seven. This is the way we like it. Down and out, and then bam, Sox Nation take over.
They like to talk about this renegade bunch and the idiots, and last year it was cowboy up. They're going to need all that swagger. They're going to need all that confidence.
We're going to fight you tooth and nail. You know, if you knock us out, that's fine. But we're going to give you all we have.
But all they had didn't appear to be enough. For in Game 4, the Yankees held a one-run lead in the ninth with their primetime playoff closer on the mound.
The Red Sox are 3 outs away from being swept.
All we kept instilling each other is to take one pitch at a time.
And there's life for the Red Sox.
A pinch runner, Dave Roberts, is going to come in for Boston.
You see the people in the stands. There's no sound. And it's just you in that moment.
Miller still waiting for his first pitch. Roberts is going.
Roberts had a great jump. Good ball for Posada to throw on.
Posada's throw, Roberts.
Chance it.
Here's the pitch.
Swing and a ground ball up the middle. Base hit center field. Here comes Roberts, rounding third, and he scores the tying run. Boston is still alive.
Boston 4, New York 4. We go to extra innings.
Postseason game in Major League history. And another golden chance to win game five. Ortiz marching up.
Dad came over here. He said, we have a chance to turn those tears into smiles. And that's something that never stopped
driving. What a dynamic clutch hitter this guy has been for the last 2 years.
The Red Sox trying to hang on to their season.
Not take a home run to win this ball game. Just a line drive, base hit in any direction.
Swing and he muscles one. Shallow center, base hit, and here comes David to win it.
And he can keep on running to New York. Game six tomorrow night.
He did it with a home run just last night, and he comes back and does it again.
Dave Ortiz has done is miraculous.
He's the f***ing God!
And you talk about earning your way back to New York. The Red Sox have earned a trip to Yankee Stadium for tomorrow night.
They're heading for New York, and Curt Schilling, the injured Curt Schilling, we'll try and get them into a seventh game.
We had to find something that was going to allow my ankle the flexibility to at least push off the rubber a little bit. Dr. Morgan came up with the suggestion to suture down the skin between the dislocated tendon and the tendon that was still in place to the tissue above the bone and basically create a wall where my tendon can't pop back in and out.
It was a very unique situation. Either we did this or he didn't pitch. And he was determined that he was going to pitch no matter what it took.
We did it and it worked, and I felt like I was going to be able to do it.
He gets an opportunity to walk on the mound at Yankee Stadium and fulfill that goal of shutting up the 55,000. Everybody who's got a soul for baseball wants to see this.
No team
has ever been down 3-0 and come back and won three in a row. No team in baseball.
I can't ever remember this place being more alive than it is right now.
I made the comment before the series started about, you know, I can think of nothing better than making 55,000 people from New York shut up. They fed me as much as any crowd ever.
Blood-soaked sock around that right ankle, like a scene from The Natural. Schilling climbs the mound and prepares to take on this Yankee lineup.
Let's see what Curt Schilling has with his wounded right ankle.
Curt Schilling is back to the hill. This time he's got a four-run cushion. Right side, Millar knocks it down. And Schilling having to get over and cover with that bad ankle.
And he was limping to first base.
Schilling ends the seventh inning with a flurry.
3 hours ago, it was unsure if he could get through an inning.
That's right.
And he got through seven, allowing one run on four hits. And it's 27-year-old Bronson Arroyo.
And Alex Rodriguez is it.
Grounded toward first.
Rolled softly up the first base side. Arroyo off the mound to get it. Nobody's covering first. He reaches out. KJ Wright, who knocks it out of his glove.
He swatted the ball out of Arroyo's hand.
Next thing I know, I'm looking and the ball's rolling all the way down the right field line. And Alex is on second base and Jeter has scored.
Jeter coming all the way around. It's a one-run game.
I've never seen that before. An error by Arroyo.
Terry Francona coming out to argue. I know when that ball is trickling down the right field line, Red Sox fans were thinking, here we go again. And they're going to call him out. They got the call right again, and they're going to bring Jeter all the way back to first base.
A-Rod is looking like the 40-year-old who spilled over the milk carton, but he knows what he did. And it's starting to get ugly here. All sorts of stuff is being showered onto the diamond here at Yankee Stadium.
They're throwing drinks and balls. This is just awful.
Throwing beer bottles, baseballs. I mean, this is turning ugly in a hurry.
This place is dangerous now.
Yankee fans should be ashamed of themselves. This is just terrible.
And now they'll try and restore order here at Yankee Stadium, as the fans have gone nuts.
Keith Foulke, day after day after day. Game four, 2 2/3 innings. Game five, an inning and a third. Now working for the third consecutive day, trying to save game six.
Tying runs are on base. Clark is the winning run.
It's Foulke's game to save or lose.
Let's go, Red Sox!
Yankees are one swing away potentially from winning.
The 3-2 pitch. Swing and a miss. He got a fastball by him. Game 7 coming up tonight.
Didn't you just feel like there had to be a Game 7? This stuff's just too good.
We have a chance to shock the United States of America.
What about the world?
The world. All right, the world. There you go. They're watching in Japan. We'll shock them too.
8 miles from New York's famed Broadway district, the compelling theater provided by the Red Sox and Yankees is drawing rave reviews, leading to another epic Game 7 showdown.
A lot of people say it's the biggest game in the history of baseball. Is it that?
This is as big a sporting event as New York City has ever seen, not just baseball. The Yankees know they're about to play a game they cannot lose.
It ain't over till it's over. They try to beat us every year, but we beat them.
It's going to say Chokers right on the front on the New York Post.
If the Red Sox win this game, this would be one of the great sports stories of all time.
Perhaps this is the way the curse has to end. This final exorcism, coming back from 3-0 like no team has ever done in baseball history.
Here we are, Game 7. Truth is stranger than fiction. And this big ballpark already rocking.
There is an eagle-eye look of determination in the Boston Red Sox faces.
It's deja vu all over again. Here we go, Game 7.
Well, one thing to remember, the Yankees have never lost a seventh game here at Yankee Stadium.
Boston has written another chapter into their tortured history. A stunning rally from three games down to their arch rivals to become the first team in Major League history to come back and force a seventh game.
Legends will be made. Goats will be born in one play, one swing of the bat tonight.
Well, here's David Ortiz, the big hulking left-hand hitter. And Brown deals.
Ortiz blasts one. Right field. There it goes. Gone. Adios, pelota. And Senor October strikes again.
Ortiz is taking on the look of a superhero. Damon hits it in the air to right field. Sheffield back at the wall. A grand slam.
Johnny Damon with one swing of the bat is giving the Red Sox four more runs. They lead it 6-0.
And the Red Sox have blown it open early. Unbelievable. There's another one in the right field. Johnny Damon is going off. And it's an 8-1 Red Sox lead.
Derek Lowe just looks sensational. He's got a one-hitter going.
Swing and a foul tip to the mitt for strike three.
Six solid innings, only one hit allowed, only one run.
That's how good Derek Lowe has been on 2 days rest.
2 days rest.
And the Red Sox fans are up and cheering in New York. And Yankee fans have been stunned here.
Just looking around Yankee Stadium, it's almost as if the fans can't comprehend what they're seeing.
They realize that time is starting to run out.
The urgency with the Yankees and their fans thinking this can't happen. The Red Sox can't come back from a 3-0 deficit.
The 1-0 pitch. Swinging a ground ball to second base. Pokey Reese has it. He throws the first, and the Red Sox have won the American League pennant. Move over, Babe. The Red Sox are American League champions.
In the world, and against that team, what an incredible accomplishment. This will be a team, and these will be players that will never, ever, ever be forgotten.
The Red Sox are closing in on it. And Keith Polk comes in to try and close it.
This wasn't simply a World Series save resting on Keith Folk's arm. This was salvation for a nation.
After decade after decade after decade of tragic baseball losses, here are the Boston Red Sox on the precipice of a four-game sweep.
Come on, Folky.
With every pitch, the past, the painful past, the past that never ceased to be the present, was washed away.
Fastball swung on and missed. He struck him out.
Two out in the ninth inning here on the banks of the Mississippi River.
The Red Sox are one out away from winning it all.
Let's go, Red Sox!
It has been 86 years since 1918. Generations have come and gone. 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 Edgar Renteria, the last chance for St. Louis to extend this game.
Folk to the set. The 1-0 pitch, here it is.
Back to Folk. Red Sox fans have longed to hear it. The Boston Red Sox are world champions.
For the first time in 86 years, the Red Sox have won baseball's world championship.
Next year is finally here.
and 86 years of frustration is finally over.
It was a thing that you dream of as a child for such a long period of time, to be able to watch it unfold in front of your eyes and be able to run on the field and celebrate with your teammates after Folky got that last out.
As soon as he hit it, I'm like, you gotta catch this ball, you gotta catch this ball. And I was actually a little early on catching it and almost missed it. But once I had it and, you know, I kind of started to run towards first, and when I got rid of it, it's like, oh my God.
When that last out was made, it's a feeling you can't, like, you're world champions.
It is the Red Sox who are the champions of the world.
When I was running, you know, it was unbelievable feeling that I can't describe it, man. I was shaking and I couldn't believe it, you know, because everything went so fast.
When you rush that mound and when you rush your teammates and you're hugging and the tears and it's what you work so hard for.
I can say without any reservations that this is the happiest moment of my life just because of the collective goal had been reached.
And now they can celebrate like idiots. That's what they've been waiting for all summer and for almost 100 years.
They had fun. This team is a testimony to the playing baseball, winning baseball, when there's a looseness and relaxation about it. It was a team of players that liked each other, that respected each other, and wanted to win for each other.
I deserve every ounce of this.
The team we have, it doesn't come around too often. A lot of teams, they have their cliques, so they shy away from each other. But our team, once one person speaks, everybody listens.
To the greatest Red Sox team ever.
The Steelers, and they're looking for an extra 1,500 tickets for the AFC Championship game next week when they go to Pittsburgh.
If we needed any motivation at all, that gave it to us, because you're basically coming into our house to play us in a playoff game, and you think you're going to come in here and walk over us. It's not going to happen.
An NFL dynasty.
And Freddie Mitchell started the week by saying, I got something for you, Rodney Harrison. Rodney Harrison finishing the week saying, I got something for you, Freddie Mitchell.
That one is hit well. That one is on its way. And goodbye. That one is hit deep. J.D. Drew has gotten a hold of one. On its way and out of here. Not low. And this game is going. going to be tied up. That one's headed for New Hampshire. What a shot. That ball is hit, and that one is on its way. Number four in a row. And they're playing home run derby early this year at Fenway Park.
Big Bobby was giving the Angels a devil of a time. So in game two, they devised a plan to stop him.
They're going to walk him. Where's Manny?
It's almost pick your poison. You can't pitch around one and pitch to the other because they're both very dangerous.
That became obvious in the bottom of the ninth. When with a score tied, they walked Ortiz for the fourth time. Manny, of course, accepted the challenge.
A-Rod to the set. He fires. A long drive to left, way back, deep into the night. Three-run walk-off home run, Manny Ramirez, and the Red Sox have won it.
I haven't been right all year round, but I guess, you know, when you don't feel good and you still get hit, that's when you know you are a bad man.
The Red Sox lead the series 2-0.
The Cleveland Indians are one win away. They've won three consecutive games from the Boston Red Sox.
Being down 3-1 against Cleveland was not a new scenario to us, having been through 2004.
The most stunning comeback in baseball history. First team ever to win a series, went down 3-0.
That was key. The veterans on the team didn't panic. In fact, they set a great example.
And we had a little team meeting after game four, and for the few guys that were here from 04, to make sure the guys that weren't here understood, we don't have to win three straight games.
We got to go out there and win one inning at a time. And if we go out there and try to win each and every inning, those innings will eventually turn into wins.
If every guy on that team plays the game one pitch, one out, one at bat at a time, there's no team on the planet that could beat us.
Although they were staring elimination in the face, it was apparent that both the Red Sox and their ever-hopeful nation saw no reason to panic.
This thing changed in an instant.
I don't think there is any question about it, and it can change like that. And that's why I think the Red Sox have a chance.
There's a new aura in Boston, and no one embodies it like the man on the mound for Game 5.
Well, it doesn't hurt when you're down 3-1 and you have the best pitcher on the planet, you know, going for you in that game, in Beckett.
He carries himself with such an air, not of arrogance.
Called strike three on the outside corner.
But of confidence.
Another strikeout for Beckett.
Having that guy that you know you're going to send out there.
The 10th strikeout of the night for Josh Beckett.
And you almost know what you're going to get. And the level that you're going to get, I think, relaxes the entire team.
The Red Sox would need all of Beckett's moxie. For through six, they were locked in a close game. And the bounces weren't going their way.
Jammed a bit, but it's still carrying at the wall, and this ball is off the top of the wall. Ortiz coming to the plate to score. The Red Sox are going to argue that ball was out.
Manny just missed a home run, and instead of a larger lead, the Sox were up by just one in the third.
A swing and a shot down the left field line. It's a foul ball by inches.
Wow.
That looked like a two-run double.
But then in what would become a trend in this postseason, Boston took a close game and blew it wide open.
Pedroia will score. Euclid goes to third, and it's 3-1 Boston.
Kicks and fires. Gets away. Goes to the backstop. Here comes the run to score. The Red Sox get another. They lead it 7-1.
In the end, Beckett was brilliant, striking out 11. And now Boston had the luxury of heading home.
Home field advantage means an enormous amount to the Boston Red Sox. We had to get back here. And what Beckett did in that game was just breathtaking.
The Boston Red Sox have done what they needed to do tonight in desperate straits. And now there will be a game six at Fenway Park.
And now this inning falls right into the lap of a guy who has not driven in a run in this series, J.D. Drew. 3-1 on Drew.
Ball center field, hit well, back goes Sizemore to the warning track by the fence, and it's gone! Grand slam, J.D. Drew! The Red Sox lead it 4-0.
JD hits a ball, not only getting a two-out RBI, but getting four in one bunch. I mean, the emotion in the ballpark, you could just feel.
JD Drew with his biggest hit ever as a member of the Red Sox.
I was very relaxed going into the at-bat. I realized we had two outs. Didn't really want to walk off the field without any runs, so just trying to hit a ball hard.
And with one swing, he erased an entire season filled with frustration, both for him and these fans here at Fenway.
JD Drew is a special player who did not have a year. I'm sure he's not real proud of the year he had. But tonight, it won the game, and it was exciting to see.
JD took the pressure off, and the Boston bats responded.
Picking him up, laying him down.
They quickly made it clear there would indeed be a Game 7 at Fenway Park.
A 12-2 pounding of the Cleveland Indians here tonight, and the Red Sox stay alive.
We're excited. We show up tomorrow and do the same thing we do every day. Kick Pedroia's ass in cribbage. Try to go win a baseball game.
Here we are, Game 7, LCS. Definitely, this is the best baseball has to offer.
All eyes were on the Game 7 starter for Boston, Daisuke Matsuzaka. And many of them, thousands of miles away, were watching in his homeland.
I think the entire nation of Japan was awake and watching that game.
Swing and a miss, he got him on a changeup.
And we saw Daisuke pitch in a way that gave us a chance to win.
Hard hit, pass Peralta. Here comes Pedroia, and the Red Sox strike first.
After the Boston offense generated a 3-0 lead, Daisuke would dodge bullets throughout the middle innings.
Swing and a miss. He got him on a changeup. Daisuke gets out of further difficulty, but the Indians get another run back.
As the Red Sox nursed a slim lead, the Indians continued to fight and nearly stole the momentum back in the seventh.
Here is Gutierrez, and a base hit could tie this game. Locked in the speedy runner at second.
Hard hit, and that's a fair ball. First and third, one out.
What is that all about?
Even though the ball hit that railing and ricocheted over to Manny, I expected to see Lofton heading home on that.
Yeah, I did too.
The Indians failed to tie the game, and the Red Sox defense quickly put an end to the Tribe's late inning rally.
To the third baseman, Lowell. Pedroia, double play, and the Red Sox keep their lead.
Riding a wave of momentum in the bottom of the seventh, the Red Sox found power from an unlikely source.
Pedroia launches one into left.
I don't even remember running on the bases, to tell you the truth.
Pedroia, a two-run shot. Red Sox up three.
It's the biggest at-bat of my life, and, you know, I'll never forget it.
And now, in the biggest game of the season, Boston was in good hands.
Blake into right center field. Chris back to his left, still going. And the Red Sox win the pennant.
The Red Sox are mobbing one another by home plate.
04 to 07, we played seven do-or-die games. We were down 3-0 to the Yankees, we won four in a row. We were down 3-1 to the Indians, we won three in a row.
They showed a lot of heart because it looked like they were dead in Cleveland.
I think that speaks to the core character of the club.
You know, we started in August last year. We're determined to take it up another notch. And then to see it happen like this, especially the way it happened, I'm just so happy for the fans of New England.
The 2007 Boston Red Sox are headed to the World Series.
The Red Sox were playing baseball at their highest level all season long, and were feeling loose as they turned to yet another rising star in a big spot. John Lester's appearance on the mound for Game 4 was the result of both a heroic battle with cancer and a teammate's decision to do what's best for the team.
The decision was made to take me off the World Series roster. I just didn't think it was fair to put those other 24 guys through that.
Wakefield's back injury gave Lester the chance of a lifetime.
Swing and a miss, he struck him out.
We had a lot of breathing room going into that game. And I think that just made me feel that much more comfortable.
Adding to his comfort was an early lead, and Lester proceeded to pitch 5 2/3 innings of shutout ball.
Swing and a miss at a high fastball. He got him.
What a performance by John Lester. And those Red Sox fans who made the trip here to Denver give him a nice round of applause, and it is well deserved.
I'm a firm believer that things like this happen for a reason. I think John Lester deserved to get that start, and what he did in Game 4 was truly inspirational for all of us.
Lester had done his part, but the game remained close until World Series MVP Mike Lowell gave Boston some breathing room.
Mike Lowell with a shot into the left field bleachers, and it is 3-0 Red Sox.
These Sox were built to win, and New Edition Bobby Kelty was the right piece in the right place at the right time.
Long drive to left field. This is deep. It is gone.
The Red Sox got him because he hits left-handers very well. Well, here he goes, and he's in the World Series. He's got his first crack at doing something. Bing, home run from the right side of the plate.
A pinch home run for Bobby Kelty in his first World Series at bat. Can you believe it? Applebaum sets the pitch. Swing and a miss. It's over. The Red Sox are the world champions of baseball for 2007.
There in that last moment was complete release, elation, just pure joy.
Veritek leaps into the arms of Papelbon in front of the mound, and the celebration is on.
People say it's never the same as the first time. It wasn't the same. It was a little bit different feeling, but just as sweet.
07 just seemed like a victory for everybody in the organization and a sense of pride.
Pride in each other and the sacrifices made along the way to reach their final destination.
I just want to say one thing. This guy right here, this win is for this man right here.
The Red Sox are World Series champions.
It's the hardest thing to do, to take yourself out of the game for someone else. But he did it, and I'm proud of him.
The World Championship of Major League Baseball once again belongs to Red Sox Nation.
Phoenix picks at number 21, and Boston has been trying to get Rajon Rondo.
It's just a great joy to be on. I'm thankful to the ownership for bringing me here.
The newest member of the Boston Celtics, Kevin Garnett.
I can say that we're going to be a force to reckon with. I will say that.
In the first round, in a game seven where anything can happen.
On the first Sunday in May, order was restored. Finally, the Celtics blew out the Hawks 99-65 in a matinee at the Garden.
Game seven was just an absolute annihilation.
The Eastern Conference semifinals brought the Celtics face-to-face with LeBron James, the NBA scoring champ.
At some point that everybody else evaporated from the court and it was just them two playing full court basketball one-on-one.
and making shot after shot.
Paul wanted it more.
Well, Paul, like the truth, like.
Brown, the jump shot, puts it in. P.J. Brown, the unlikely hero.
LeBron finished with 45 points. Pierce, 41. But the play that will never be forgotten came with a minute to play and didn't even show up in the box score.
Lagauskas on the second tip. Pierce comes up with it and calls timeout. He gets the timeout. Paul Pierce making every big play for the Celtics today.
Really exemplified what that team was all about. Whatever was necessary, they were going to do.
Allen comes off the screen, fires a three, puts it in. That's a two. His foot was on the line, but he knocks down a big shot.
The series shifted back to Motown for Game 6, with Boston holding a 3-2 lead. The Celtics were focused on one thing and one thing only: ending the Pistons' season.
Posey with the steal, he took it away!
The Celtics won the game, 89-81, and were heading back to the NBA Finals for the first time since 1987.
Fall like a butterfly, sting like a bee! Let's go, baby, we're in the finals.
Oh, are they ready here in the city of Boston? The Beat LA chants started about an hour ago. With all due respect to the 28 other teams, when it comes to the championship round, this is the NBA's marquee matchup.
Dating back to 1959, the Celtics and Lakers had met 10 times in the finals. For decades, the rivalry was massively one-sided. Boston owned the Lakers, beating them 8 straight times for titles. In 1985, Los Angeles finally broke through. They followed that up with another win in 1987. More than 2 decades later, the league's reigning MVP squared off against 3 stars hungry for their first title.
We gotta compete if we wanna win. We can't pout and mope. We gotta compete, all right?
Free throw action comes in. Right hand, don't burn it! According to Phil Jackson, it's still the heart and soul. Draws the foul, banks it in, and one.
Outright hustle by Rondo. That's a 6'10 power forward shooting a jumper, blocks the shot, and then on the other end, finishing at the rim. Paul Pierce says, that's what I'm talking about, Rondo.
Rondo, back to Pierce, another three. Puts it in, back-to-back three-pointers for Paul Pierce.
Instead of looking for Kobe Bryant coming to the rim, shakes the ball, says no, isolation, and then gets the back.
Pierce got it, and a foul. Not giving a good pass. Pierce to Poe, Leon Poe. Wow, and the Celtics by 22. Rondo, ball fake to Poe again.
Reason trying to fight Allen to three. Knocks it down. His fourth three-pointer of the game. I see one guy that's coming ready to play, and that's Kobe Bryant.
Bryant on the block. Kobe Bryant. Opponent's fans can't stand him. Shot clock at 5. He wants a better look. Gets a better look. And puts it in. And this best of 7 series is now 2-1. The Lakers with a ball in play. A touch to Gasol at the rim for the jam. On a feed from Odom at the foul line.
LA's onslaught continued, leaving Boston facing a mountain that seemed impossible to climb.
Sends it outside to Vujicic, who sticks a three out of the right corner. And the Lakers have their biggest lead at 24.
Come on, guys!
My first thought was Mbutu, and that's what I said in the huddle. There's going to come a moment where you're going to face unreal adversity. And that's when the word Mbutu and playing together will come through for you. This is it. This is adversity that we can overcome. And we're going to win.
With a pass to Pierce, right side, drives past Odom to the rim and scores. Paul Pierce.
At this point, we just got to take it one possession at a time. Don't anybody look up at the clock.
Shot clock, Pierce, excellent defensive play.
guys, you know, just saying, just stay with it. Just cut it down. Just chip at it a little bit.
Eddie House, nice feed to Posey, and the layup. Pretty pass from Eddie House, and it's back to 13 again.
Sam Cassell said it from the bench. He said, this is what it feels like when you win a championship. This is how hard it is. And if you want it, you have to go out there and grab it.
Ray Allen to the basket and banks it in. And it's 11. This is the closest they've been. Celtics have tried to chip away. Pierce to the basket. Lots of contact. Count it. And a foul. What a move from Pierce as the lead is cut to 10.
When you get in a big deficit like that and you're down by so much, You fight.
Left corner house, a three is good. It's a 6-point game.
We're down 27 minutes to go in the third quarter, and we're still saying, get it to 10. Just get it to 10. And when we look up, it's a 2-point game.
Down low to Brown to the rim for the jam. It's a 2-point game.
Never stop believing, baby.
Despite their furious comeback, the Celtics hadn't been able to take the lead, and Kobe Bryant was out to make sure they never would.
Bomb on the rebound, up the near side, Bryant. Kobe inside, jams it down.
The MVP of the NBA trying to win a championship for the Lakers.
All right, we're right there. Gotta believe, guys. Do you believe?
All right, let's go.
Bounces it. Garnett saves the possession. Back to Ray Allen. They leave him alone, so he steps inside the free throw line. Kick to the corner. Posey, three. Got it. And the Celtics are within one. The Boston Celtics have never led in game number four. They've got it now, trailing by one with 4:13 to go. Pierce to his left. Blitz by Farmore. Kick out pass. Eddie House jump shot. 18 feet. Circles the rim. Falls in good. And the Boston Celtics have their first lead of the night.
This crowd absolutely stunned.
When you think about being down and going through the adversity, it just shows you what a team can do if you stick together and believe in one another. Ray, sell it better for me, all right? When he dribbles this way, Ray, Kevin's diving, I need you to come up, all right?
And Ray Allen would take care of the rest.
Ray Allen in the corner, takes a step around Kobe, hangs in the air, reverses it up, and gets it to go! History is unfolding in front of our eyes tonight at Staples Center. One possession away from taking a 3-1 series lead. Ray Allen straight away up top. Shot clock at 6. This is going to be Sugar Ray here against Vujicic. Down the right side, steps past him, gets to the rim. Reverses it up and in with the left hand.
And the Celtics are going to take a 3-1 lead in these finals. What an amazing turnaround here in game 4.
That's how you do it.
No!
That's how you fight.
One more.
Hey. Let's go. One more, Steve.
Good stuff.
Hey, listen, number one, that's a great win. And we should be excited about the win. But this, again, this is not our goal to win 3 games. Our goal is to win 4 games, all right?
So, yeah. Yeah. We're hanging in there. We're hanging in there.
We're hanging in there.
Team.
Good job, hey, guys.
One, two, three. Rondo drives the basket, kicks it out to Allen. For three. And the Celtics go up by 20. Against Gasol. A high release. 36-point lead. Garnett inside. Banks it in. And a foul. What a play from Kevin Garnett. Alley-oop.
Just an hour of the clock winding down. The Boston Celtics are NBA champions once again.
And now we bring all champions 17. Yeah! Anything's possible.
Single season turnaround in NBA history is complete. Banner number 17 soon to be raised to the Raptors.
And the Bruins make it official. They win the Northeast Division.
Securing home ice advantage for another playoff bout with their hated Northern rivals.
Montreal is the great hockey city in the world. Boston is the great hockey city in the United States.
There's something really special between Boston and Montreal, and that is an enmity that is genuine.
And we have blood all over the ice to Rappel. Score! Sweden, shoot, hit, and go!
I grew up in Boston. For the Bruins to beat Montreal anytime, that's jubilation for me.
Playing against Montreal is always very intense. These games are extremely emotional and physical.
And somewhere, Eddie Shore and Maurice Richard are smiling because the pot's boiling all the time.
There were fans in Boston that didn't want the Canadians. They thought it was a difficult matchup for Boston. I welcomed it. You know, if you're going to win the Stanley Cup and you can go through Montreal doing it, that's the best.
The series opened in Boston, where the visiting Canadiens took control, outscoring the Bruins 5-1 en route to two road victories.
Oh, wide open net, and you could just feel the frustration in Boston here.
Boy, this building is quiet
as the Montreal Canadiens will celebrate winning back-to-back games in rather convincing fashion.
They lost both games, and both at home.
They're going up to Montreal. To me, it's the toughest building in the league to win. This doesn't look real good.
Tim Thomas coming up huge as Montreal has the high octane in the tank.
Impressive victory by the Bruins, Jack.
After last season's brutal playoff exit at the hands of the Flyers, this Boston Bruins team sought redemption.
The Bruins were on a mission. Exorcise the demon from a year ago.
I think that we all felt before this season started that we had unfinished business because for what happened last year in the playoffs.
Oh, and Coburn sent down by McQuaid. Another shot.
Gregory Campbell right in front. His first career playoff goal. And the Bruins have put up seven.
After a 7-3 victory in Game 1, Tim Thomas and the Bruins hope to carry the momentum into Game 2.
And the shots just started to add up, and I started feeling better and more confident about myself.
50 Philadelphia shots.
It switched from just making them work at it to being convinced in my mind that I just wasn't going to let them score.
Moving in is Briere, and he is stopped by Thomas.
Thomas turned away 46 straight shots, setting up David Krejci for some redemption of his own.
Now Krejci with a drive. Went to review, and the Bruins win it in overtime.
Shot from the right point gives the Bruins a 2-1 lead in the third.
Turner was up there, too.
Down there, shot,
wasn't a real natural rivalry between those two teams. You had to kind of build that hatred.
Tampa Bay up three in the first period.
Boston was aggressive, but sloppy, sorely missing one of their best defensive forwards.
When Bergeron's out of the lineup, there's a broadside hole on the boat.
He goes down, and now they bring in the kid.
Taken into the slot, turning it around Lundin. He does put it on net, and he scores! A beautiful goal by Tyler Seguin in his first playoff game.
Sean Thornton told Tyler Seguin, your game days have to be the practice days.
He was a healthy scratch the first however many games.
I said if we're going to win a championship, you're going to have to contribute somehow, so be prepared in case you got the call.
Sagan's goal and helper weren't enough in game one, but after falling behind early in game two, the Bruins again turned to their prize rookie.
Seguin one on two, trying to split the D. He does. He's to the net all alone, a backhand, and he scores!
Came in and played an unbelievable couple games for us.
Seguin contributed to four of Boston's five second-period goals, and the Bees held off a late lightning surge to even the series at one.
Malone to skate it to the right circle, backhands in the front, Gagne, a wrist shot, and he scores! On a Lucic turnover at center, it leads to the Tampa goal by Simone Gagne.
It was a catastrophic collapse. You had to think you were caught in some pre-2004 Red Sox nightmare.
An empty net goal sealed game four for the Bolts. In game five, Boston scored twice in the second period and held on as their goaltender once again stifled the Lightning offense. Despite a game six hat trick from David Krejci, the Bees were unable to finish the series in Tampa Bay, forcing another game seven back in Boston.
Game seven was as good a hockey game as I have ever witnessed. Right from the opening faceoff, fans were sitting on the edge of their seat. Nobody sat down.
So who gets the first big hit? The first big scoring chance? Who makes the first remarkable save?
Across to Marty St. Louis, and he got drilled by Seidenberg at center ice.
I thought game seven against Tampa was the best game they played in the playoffs.
Taken there by Krejci, gave it to the back.
Pat Pepperly to Lucic, in alone, Lucic, wrist shot on the save, Rollison.
The first 10 bell save of the day.
It was an epic back and forth battle. Not a penalty was called of any kind on either team.
Probing for the first goal of this game continues. Now Chara with a shot deflected off of Rollison. Montgomery Bergeron, a shot knocked down by Pepperly, another shot by Gagne, what a goal!
When the fire takes over, what is running, what's pumping, as the battle gets closer.
Past the halfway point of the third period of a scoreless game seven.
Cause we'll be screaming now. We can be heroes everywhere we go. We can have all that we ever want.
New England has Stanley Cup fever again.
And the Bruins win! The Bruins win! They're in the Stanley Cup final! LaPierre wrestles Zdeno Chara to the ice.
He better get some help. He had something on his hand, like maybe a bite.
You can't bite in this league, no matter how hungry you are for a championship.
Nearing the last minute, five now.
Kessler makes a nice play, sends it across, a chance here for hits, and let's go!
Win, they get home ice. If the Canucks win, a stranglehold.
Blocked by Edler, turned back the other way. Here comes Burrows, fakes,
He got Thomas down and out. He scores! 11 seconds into overtime.
And so the cup final shifts to Boston, home of the Bruins since 1924, and where the last cup final game was May 24th, 1990.
Horton
is down and he is hurt.
The hit on Horty was, I don't even know how to describe it. You're just sad to see your friend get hurt.
It was late, really late. You know what I mean? I got to give him five in game.
Our first concern, I think, was how he was doing. I mean, as much as he's such an important player for our team, he's a friend of all of ours.
And the fans salute and we all hope for the best for Nathan Horton.
Around the hit on Nathan Horton, and it kind of got us fired up and going, and we headed in the right direction.
Andrew Ferris, 11 seconds into the second period.
It's amazing what a single goal can do in terms of charging a team with momentum.
Ryder looking back toward a recce, the bottom of the red circle, center, one score! And recce will get credit for the power play goal as it deflected in. It's 2-0 Bruins. Here's a chance now for Malhotra, and a save is made by Thomas.
In that game, the luck started to come on our side.
Marchand going towards the net. He's free, but an unbelievable scores. What a goal by Brad Marchand, shorthanded.
We had the momentum, and we wanted to make sure that we kept it.
Here's Michael Ryder with a shot. Big rebound, Pitchy scores.
Four goals for the Bruins on the last 13 shots this period.
And the Canucks badly need to get to the intermission.
Through the game's first two periods, Boston's physical presence was overwhelming. In the third, it was devastating.
Thomas makes a body check. Multitasking.
Thomas is banging guys in the crease, and they're all over them.
I now think that everyone on the Bruins has a hit in this game.
That was a very emotional night at the Boston Garden. It felt like the 70s. Physical, it was high scoring.
Centering pass, score! Mark Recce!
This is another goal scored by Kelly, making seven.
And the Bruins are blowing out the Canucks. It's 8-1. 3:50 against Luongo.
All of a sudden, what looked like a short series became something a lot more than that.
Fans in Boston will count down the seconds. Their team back in the Stanley Cup Final in a big way.
And game four of the 2011 Stanley Cup Final is underway.
Can they come back and win again? Absolutely. I think they found a formula that works, and that's to play extremely physical hockey.
Rink wide pass on the stick of Krejci. He'll chip it up ahead. Peverly has a step to the net. Peverly, a wrist shot, and he scores! Peverly in alone gives the Bruins the 1-0 lead.
Tim Thomas stepped up again and refused to let the Canucks score.
LaPierre trying to get around McQuaid. He does. He cuts in. Thomas will save. Blue puck in the blue paint. And the puck is covered up by the glove of Thomas. Oh, what a save.
He's a battler in the net. You know, he does anything he can to save that puck.
Thomas just looked like he's out playing shinny. He just looked calmly there. Yeah, he's aggressive.
The thought occurred that it's almost like he's rubbing his nose in it by not even trying.
He doesn't even look like he's working at it.
While Thomas remained unbeatable, Roberto Luongo struggled to stop Boston scorers in the second and third periods.
Bennett ahead, Ryder walks it into the zone. Here's Ryder shooting, he scores!
Well, right now it's regroup time. They hopped on a plane 4 days ago with a 2-0 lead, everything going their way, energy galore. And in a matter of just less than six periods, lots of questions, and that energy is going the other way in the Boston Bruins.
Tim Thomas trying to get his third shutout of these playoffs, and he will have it.
What a response from Vancouver. The Canucks are a win away from their first Stanley
big first goal. A great shot by Brad Marchand. 1-0 Bruins.
And out to center ice, and the Bruins try to hammer it back in deep and hit now Holtrup. And now with some speed, Heavily drops it back. A chance for Lucic. He scores! Milan Lucic puts it through the logo. It is 2-0 Boston.
If this building wasn't crazy after two goals in 35 seconds, it went completely bonkers when Nathan Horton was shown on the big screen. He's in the building tonight cheering on his teammates.
For the 16th time in Stanley Cup Finals history, a Game 7 Wednesday night, Rogers Arena in Vancouver.
While the Canucks were happy to be leaving the Garden, they were unaware that part of it was coming to Vancouver.
Was there something in the water in Boston? 15 minutes ago, Nathan Horton took a Gatorade bottle and poured some water on the ice. What do you think he's doing?
Yeah, you see the way they played in Boston? Of course there's something in the water in Boston.
He's been all stealth about it, checking the sides.
It wasn't my idea, but I'll take credit for putting it on the ice because that's what I did.
He came back in the room. He said, "It's our ice now."
One game, winner take all.
Got up in the morning and the nervousness was there. The anticipation was there.
I know there was a lot of sweating going on amongst our team. I felt like my job as a goalie was to give off the aura that I was relaxed and confident.
82 games and 2 months of war. No sport in the world does what we do in hockey.
Fins back in deep.
Berge always finds that soft spot in the high slot. He's so good at getting that shot off. I just had to find an area and he would get to it.
Feeds it in front. Score!
Still to this day, don't know how he saw it. He went through two or three bodies.
Patrice Bergeron on the slot, set up by Marchand.
Kind of took a minute to realize it went in for both of us.
And the Bruins with a 1-0 lead in the first.
We're ecstatic, you know, we're both kind of jumping around and just kind of set the tempo for the game.
It gave us so much energy, you know. Obviously, when your team scores, it just kind of lifts you up, right? So when you score in Game 7 in the Stanley Cup Finals, then, you know, try to catch me.
From that point forward, we just kind of feel like we got this.
Got the lead and you know, that kind of like get us going, and we got second, third, and we were just in control of the game.
Lawrence kicks it a little, Bergeron. Bergeron trying to settle it down the middle, being chased. Bergeron to the net, bumped down by Erhoff. Score! And rolled in! Bergeron gets it shorthanded, and the Bruins have a 3-0 lead. With 5 seconds to go, the exit behind the Canucks net. Get the duck boats ready. After 39 long years, the Cup is back home. It's our 2011 Stanley Cup champion.
The Bruins are gathered, awaiting the arrival of the Stanley Cup.
Describe the feelings you get when you do get a hold of it.
It's the greatest day of your life.
The line divides runner and finisher. Then and now. Hurt and healing. The line connects. The fear and the will. The few and the many. The memory and the city.
Please join us now in a moment of silence for the victims of yesterday's tragedy at the Boston Marathon.
When we stood on the foul line on the 16th in Cleveland, it was in that moment of silence and knowing what has transpired over the previous 24 hours that not only was it a galvanizing moment for us, but it was an insight into that this group really understood their place in the city.
We talked about it. It wasn't something that we just did. It was something we talked about, wanting to do this for the city.
It was an extremely emotional time in Cleveland, hanging that 617 jersey. That's kind of where it started for us, that feeling of what can we do as a team. And what we can do is very little, but we're going to give everything we have to give something back to the city.
5 days after the tragic event, the Red Sox played their first game back at Fenway.
All right, Boston.
where the collective will of a team and a town was being tested.
This jersey that we wear today, it doesn't say Red Sox. It say Boston.
I think I was just getting things out of my chest at the time, you know, like, I love the city and I love the people here so much. This is my home.
We want to thank you, Mayor Menino, Governor Patrick, the whole police department, for the great job that they did this past week.
For me, speaking that day and saying what I say, it was natural. It was something that I was feeling it. It was something that came out of me without thinking about it twice.
This is our city. And nobody gonna dictate our freedom. Stay strong.
What David said, that's not just how he felt and how we all feel, but it's everybody here. And that day, to see everybody come back, all the guys on the team were just happy we could take the people around the city's focus off what they were going through and hopefully put a smile on their face.
Two on and two out here in the last half of the eighth inning. 2-1 Kansas City.
Now Daniel Nava. Nava hits it in the air to right field. Craig Hoare going back. He's at the wall. Boston, this is for you. A three-run home run puts the Sox on top. 4-2.
I was certainly not trying to hit home run.
Goodness gracious. And this place goes crazy.
I'm not too emotional on the field when that ball went over the wall. I think there's a lot of relief.
Sox have won seven straight, but this one at home at Fenway Park was important.
Probably the most emotional day that I've ever seen at Fenway Park. It was just incredible to see.
That day really set the groundwork for what could have been a really special year.
Sox trailing 5-1, and Poppy gets in. He's never homered against Benoit in his career. Bases loaded. Two out. Benoit delivers. Swinging a high knee, driving to right field. That one's scalded to right. Hunter on the move, racing back. It's over his head. It's gone. It's into the bullpen. This game is tied. This game is tied. David Ortiz. David Ortiz. David Ortiz. Shane Victorino. Bases loaded. One out. Detroit up by one in the seventh.
A high fly ball, left field deep, down the line, toward the wall, grand slam! Shane Victorino with a grand slam, and the Red Sox have the lead!
Throw to first, got him picked, he's out! He got him! He's out at first, and the ball game is over! Koji picked him off! He picks off Wong, and the World Series is tied.
Walker ready. He kicks and fires. Swing. There's a fly ball left field deep. And this ball is going to be off the green. It hits the committee inside. Ellsbury scores. Ortiz scores. Here comes Gomes to the plate. The throw. He slides. He saves. Three-run score, and over to third, Victorino pounding his chest, 3-0 Red Sox.
The Red Sox have three more outs to get, and they are world champions in 2013. Koji is on the mound, and the pitch. Swinging a high fly ball, lofted into left center, Ellsbury on the move. Call up by Gomes, Gomes is there, he one-hands it. One man out in the ninth inning for St. Louis. Popped him off in the left field, coming on Gomes. He wants another one. He's got it. Two down. Two down in the ninth. Koji ready. He turns on the rubber. The 2-2 home. Swing and a miss. He struck him out. The 2013 Red Sox are the world champions. And Boston Strong. Bedlam at Fenway Park. As the Red Sox clinch the World Series at Fenway for the first time in 95 years. We'll be right back.
some loud music out there. There's going to be people questioning play calling, personnel grouping. That's not going to go away until you fix it. It's not.
And we sit with the quarterbacks and the head coaches every week. And when we sat with Tom Brady, we've done this for a lot of years. Tom was tight. He was aggravated. He was not happy with the way things are going offensively. And you see it. This is as frustrated as I've ever seen Tom Brady in Washington since 2000.
He's struggling himself, and they've got a long way to go to solve their problems on offense. They're not running the ball. They're not pass protecting. They can't stretch the field. And here's Jimmy Garoppolo.
Tom Brady was benched. For all of you out there in the world, Tom Brady was benched. It happens to each and every quarterback in the league. Now,
I'm so concerned that I'm going to say publicly, I'm not sure if he's in decline.
Tom Brady was benched for his ineffective play. Garoppolo got in there and moved the ball downfield and got the ball in the end zone. If this continues on for another 5 or 6 weeks, believe the rumblings will start that this could be Tom Brady's last year in New England. I put it out there first.
Jay?
If you don't understand.
Tom Brady's last year in New England?
This could be, if this goes on for about 6-7 more weeks, there'll be rumblings about maybe is this it for Tom Brady.
Are you crazy, dude? We saw a weak team, the New England Patriots. Let's face it, they're not good anymore.
Yeah, well, we're on to Cincinnati. We're on to Cincinnati.
What do you think having a 37-year-old?
We're on to Cincinnati. It's nothing about the past, nothing about the future. It's right now we're preparing for Cincinnati.
Like Tom Brady again today, baby. And I went out there with my teammates and we made Tom Brady look like Tom Brady after you guys were criticizing him all week. The fans, everything. And it feels so good, and he's such a leader. And he went over 50,000 yards today. He's an unbelievable player, and I'm so glad to play with him.
We're certainly not big on individual stats around here, but 50,000 yards, Tom.
And welcome to Super Bowl 49.
Getting a critical mass now at 11:15 left in this football game.
The signature play of the last Super Bowl came on that 3rd and 14 play.
Hanging in despite a huge hit from Cam Chancellor.
It's a money catch right there.
Tom Brady and the Patriots looking for a fourth quarter drive to take the lead here at Super Bowl 49.
Best quarterback that we've ever seen play the game.
Hands down, I said it right before I got to New England. Hands down, the greatest ever. I had in return for grace.
It's a beautiful day. Patriots, they're back in the lead. It's Super Bowl 49.
With Big C Dyer. What do you do in life? You go right to people that you can depend on.
Russell in the pocket. Russell for Carson. That's broken up again. And is it? But somehow, oh, and he winds up with a football.
I think Butler hit it and it fell right back down to the ground. Unbelievable. How many different plays are the Patriots going to have like this? Yep. Mario Manningham, David Tyree.
Right. This was,
and now a curse.
This was where Tyree had the helmet catch.
But they're not in yet.
It's on his mind. It has to be. Here he goes. Beast mode.
half-yard line.
And now New England has to think about taking a timeout. You bleed the clock all the way down. They're bleeding it right down to half a minute. Second and goal. Baldwin sets up on the left. Play clock is five.
Stack receivers, two to the right. Russell Wilson extends the hands. He has it. Wilson, quick throw. And it's intercepted. Intercepted by Malcolm Butler. Butler has it at the one. Malcolm Butler stepped in front of the throw. And the Patriots have possession with 20 seconds to go.
How obsessed were you to get the fourth title?
Well, it's been a long journey. I mean, I've been at it for 15 years, and we've had a couple of tough losses in this game, and this one came down to the end, and this time we made the plays.
This one could close it out. Brady, though, goes down the field to Gronkowski, and he has the football at the 10-yard line. With the game on the line, Brady. In the pocket, end zone bound, and it is caught by Gronkowski to make it 20-18. He got away from the Denver defenders.
It comes down to the two-point conversion.
Fans. A federal appeals court has ruled that New England Patriots quarterback Tom Brady must serve a four-game suspension stemming from the so-called Deflategate scandal.
Tom Brady's just about done. It could be his next game he plays, it could be a year from now, but he is going to fall off a cliff. Tom Brady is going to be a bum in short order.
What happens if Jimmy plays better?
Look, I told you what's going to happen.
So there's no...
Jesus Christ.
I'm scared as hell of Brady right now. I mean, this dude is on another level to begin with, but what I think he's going to do right now, as if this dude, who is clearly an ultra competitor, who is a four-time Super Bowl champion, okay, who's been to six Super Bowls, as if he needed additional motivation. Me, I found myself thinking the end of the Deflategate, and the first words out of my mouth was, uh-oh. I mean, he's going to walk through the door one Patriot way, I believe, this morning. And it's going to be a scary sight
assassin
to see. Because he has the assassin's mentality. He has that killer, that dog in him. And it's going to be a problem for a lot of teams.
Damn. I mean, I know this, I mean, this TV blitz. You don't just miss four games and then come out and just go 40 yards like that.
Brady. Not gonna go deep.
with this game.
Yep, and here he comes.
He places the rep. He had this look in his eye. He always had that look, but it was different this time.
Let's go!
Over 500 days into the fiasco known as Deflategate.
Home, Cincinnati, the return of Tom Brady.
Shotgun from Brady.
Hogan down the sideline. Spun down. There's the big play New England was looking for. First and goal. Inside the five. Brady tosses. No throws. Gronk has got it. Touchdown, Patriots. Rob Gronkowski with the hands. Make the handoff. Brady all the way after. Wide open, Gronkowski. Rob Gronkowski releasing, and a big play to the tight end, Tom Brady, career completion number 5,000 for Brady, fourth all time.
4 for 4 on the drive.
Tom Brady is back.
Brady under pressure, trying to escape, throw into the end zone, touchdown, Amendola.
25. And Brady, deep downfield, makes the catch. Brady throws it, Edelman is there, and he makes the catch.
Second and four, they got it right. Now Brady going deep.
Quarterback 201.
Whoa, you let your football.
He's gonna keep that football.
They appear in the AFC Championship game for a record 6th straight year. The saying goes, here around Foxborough, one more. One more means an NFL record. 9th trip to the Super Bowl.
Touchdown!
Let's go!
Great players of my lifetime. Once you're great, having somebody to tell you you're not always great is not the easiest thing to do, and Duncan and Brady set the bar.
What a cut!
I thought I saw the symbolic end of Tom Brady.
Touchdown, Atlanta!
What is this going to end up being, like 35-10? Are they going to bring that f***ing bench in?
End zone!
Side of the Patriots offensive line, pass is picked, inner.
intercepted.
When he leaps out to the best of his ability and he comes up empty as the DB runs by him and he lays there, I thought that was the end.
And the Falcons add to their lead. Alford with a pick six.
Tom Brady is overrated.
Two images that I'm going to remember for a very, very long time. After the pick six in the first half, it was 21 to nothing. They cut to Brady on the bench, head down.
Yes.
2:21 left in the first half.
And then, for sure, it was game over when the Falcons scored to make it 28-3 with 8:31 left in the third quarter.
It made people think like, oh my God, Tom Brady has fallen off a cliff and it's over.
Like a laser, eye to eye, and he said, that's right, and I'm the best decision this organization has ever made.
And then, here comes Brady.
He doesn't have the strongest arm, but he's got the greatest will. And pre-snap, drive, focus, endurance, discipline, efficiency. Things that don't sell on the Kardashian show, but things that provide him with an edge on every other competitor.
I wasn't even saying that we were coming back. I was, well, maybe they'll make it a little respectable. I don't know.
Touchdown!
This Patriots crowd just took over the stadium.
They got the fumble sack.
New England has it. Hightower knocked it out.
And they showed Brady's reaction. That was the first time I actually thought the Pats had a chance.
It's very hard to imagine anyone thinking at 28-3, with 23 minutes left in this game, that the Patriots could come out of their doldrums and really start attacking.
This is four down territory for New England.
It's simply through the force of Tom Brady's will.
First down, folks.
It's not even debate anymore. There is no more debate. People don't do their homework if they do debate.
He is the greatest quarterback that has ever played.
That's the GOAT, like the GOAT all time. Not just any position, every position.
Touchdown!
From 28-3 on, I just can't imagine another quarterback who could have done that.
It's the ball to the Patriots. This is a big two-point conversion here to really apply the pressure on the Falcons.
Kevin Falk play right there. Now we got a ball game, folks.
It's good. James Watt. It's a one-score game. It's Super Bowl 51.
Including Kyle Shanahan. Do not take a sack.
Opportunity missed after that incredible catch by Julio Jones.
Oh, it was such a good drive for Atlanta. Now they're giving the ball back, and they're going to put Tom Brady in position.
They go 91 yards here. They'll have a chance to tie it. And he's out of bounds with another first down.
New England not only mounted a comeback, but played a virtually flawless last 45 minutes. Spearheaded once again by the GOAT, the greatest quarterback I've ever seen.
There have been seven comebacks of 25 points or more in NFL history. 15,000 games, only seven.
And we are at the two-minute warning.
The greatest performance I've ever seen.
Ryan, finish off this comeback.
He's right in there with Babe Ruth, Muhammad Ali, Michael Jordan, and Tom Brady. Those are the four guys on my Mount Rushmore.
Tom Brady now, somehow, is over 400 yards passing in this game.
Tom Brady threw for 246 yards in the fourth quarter alone.
Touchdown, James White!
That's Clay Thompson. That's unbelievable.
Now the biggest two-point attempt in the history of the Patriots franchise. This is a tie game. Don't ever count Tom Brady out. Best ever. best ever in my book. It's the best I've seen, and he's put on a show here in the last 30 minutes of this ball game, and to climb back in it.
The word of Matthew Slater, heads win the coin toss.
Phil does carry that chip on his shoulder. He's carried it around his entire career. It's driven him. It's what's made him great.
The opening kickoff to the first ever overtime in Super Bowl history.
Every 3 years.
Not quite.
I know.
I wish.
It seems like every 3 years I see you, which is cool. I mean, I almost get giddy because I get to watch you on television. I get to enjoy your career. You ever sat back, pinch yourself when nobody's looking and going, wow.
Yeah, every day.
How blessed am I?
Every day, every day. It's, I never imagined, you know, being in this situation. You know, I've just been so blessed. I got to the Patriots at the right time, you know, in 2000, and Coach Belichick got there, and we've been on this magical run. And, you know, I still feel like we're in it.
He's one of the great competitors, one of the greatest quarterbacks to ever play this game.
I got a quote here. I'm going to read it to you. It's, with determination, a person can link leadership and confidence to create an image of ability and brilliance. They want to be associated with a winner. And if you can give the impression of being a winner, people then will follow you. Isn't that great?
I love that.
Yeah, that is just like everything that a quarterback is.
Yeah. You know, yeah. When you get in the huddle and you call those plays, you got 10 other guys that are feeling your energy. And what are you putting off? Are you putting off confidence? Are you putting off fear? You know, they can feel all that. And when they get in the huddle with me, I want to look in their eyes, and I want them to feel a belief that we're going to do it.
It's okay for you to think good about yourself, because there's enough people out there writing bad about you, right?
That's true.
At 39, I know you want to play as long as you possibly can. Maybe it's history. Maybe you're the first to win 5 Super Bowls. How cool would that be? Yeah. And I get to hand you the trophy.
Yeah.
I may drop it on your foot.
That would mean we won, so you can do whatever the hell you want.
Yeah, I know if I can. Win.
I want to be standing there with you, too, with that trophy, because I think we got a hell of a team.
Yeah.
I think we got a great football team. And I want this team to be remembered that way, but the only way you can is if you win the game.
If you win the game, do you walk away?
Hell no.
Well,
hell no.
No, all right, no. Fine. Got to defend it.
Yeah, there's no way, because I'm having too much fun now. So this is the time to capitalize. I've worked hard to get to this point.
Go score and win this thing, baby, for your mom, bro.
A rally that was next to impossible, more than improbable.
Julian Edelman.
To me, he was so great late last night in that game that he rendered the Deflategate saga irrelevant.
But that was mythical. That's Halo stuff. That's Zaire. That's 104 hitting jumpers. It's the first time I walked out and I'm like, he's floating to that locker room.
And he was as great as you could possibly be. In the history of pro football, who's had a fourth quarter?
No.
You know what my favorite ring is? The next one. That's my favorite.
Diving to the goal line! It's the one! Touchdown! And a title for the Patriots!
I can't believe it!
They have completed the greatest comeback in Super Bowl history. Led by the greatest quarterback.
One more in New England, and you got it.
But a lot has transpired during the last 2 years. And I don't think that needs any explanation. This is unequivocally... the sweep.
Locked in, boy. It is Stanton or bust.
Look, I just think that they need a stud. They need a franchise guy. They need a, look, there's a business reason and there's a baseball reason, and they have both. It's time. I just think, look, you had more home runs hit in the game this year than have ever been hit in a major league season before. Mm. And the best you could do is a guy in the mid-20s. And you know what? Take all the numbers out of it. I just think they have a lot of guys that you can pitch to mitigate. This guy you can't pitch to mitigate.
If they sign J.D. Martinez and he does what he did last season or close to it, why couldn't he be the star power that you're looking for? Why do you need that star power going into the year? Why can't you just have it at the end of the year or by midseason once he's established here?
Okay, for the two-letter word you just used, if. if he does what he did. This guy to me, Stanton, is far closer to a sure thing.
Really is a head scratcher when you consider the Red Sox won the division last year, yet we look at the 2017 Red Sox as this band of misfits that didn't get along and didn't win. That really wasn't the case last year.
Stanton waives his no-trade clause to go to New York. On the surface, the Yankees don't end up giving up a ton here. How big of a win is this for the Yankees, who were already just one win away from the World Series a year ago?
I mean, certainly a lot of clubs are going to try to scramble to catch up with them, most of all the Red Sox, who are probably looking on in horror what happened this weekend in New York.
The dog days of winter are upon us, folks. I mean, it's a Tuesday in February. Just the worst. But it is also the day when pitchers and catchers report, and that is a perfect reminder of happy times ahead for all the great people of the world enlightened enough to love the greatest franchise in the history of human athletic competition, the New York Yankees. Mind you that our impending best of times will come at a cost. Yes, the cost is the sorrow of every other team in baseball, and without it, a Yankees fan's joy would never achieve its full depth. Add their futility to Yankee greatness, and only then can you know true pleasure. Most likely batting second for this latest iteration of the Bronx Bombers will be one of the two best home run hitters in baseball, a giant who just led the American League with over 50 home runs as a rookie. Most likely batting right behind him will be the other best home run hitter in baseball, an almost equally gigantic slugger who just led the NL in home runs, ending the season one shy of 60. This is not Ruth and Gehrig or Mantle and Maris. It's Ruth and Ruth. It's Mantle and Mantle. It's Judge and Stanton. Oh, and they might not even be the best hitters in the lineup. Gary Sanchez, the freaking catcher, has hit 53 home runs in his first 177 major league games. If you're like in high school or middle school right now, welcome to how it really is, and really always has been. Ask any honest adult, they'll tell you. The zero-sum contest for happiness is underway, and the 27-time World Series champion New York Yankees have a lineup built to destroy. Join in if you like, or stick with the team from your town. I'd wish you luck, but it wouldn't help, and I wouldn't mean it. Let's play ball.
Unfortunately, J.D. Martinez, as we heard Anthony just say, probably the biggest fish left, the guy that can provide the most thump. But where do you play him? Your outfield is pretty packed.
Okay, fine. It's good to not overspend. I always agree with that. You still need to get the player at the end of the day. Weren't you the guy in the Stanton argument saying, it's not your money, it's ownership's money. Spend whatever amount of money
it takes. For a legit superstar, not for a guy who had a contract.
Their numbers aren't that different.
I'm sorry, Evan.
It's
that
just
is
interesting
red
that now
central.
You're concerned with reasonable spending.
It seems
like a flip-flop.
I want to spend on legit, actual superstars, not someone no one around here has ever heard of.
But I will here attempt, do my best at least, to vilify the Red Sox and everyone who works for them and plays for them, because they're terrible. What whiners, what complainers in Boston. It's so obnoxious. Like, for 80-something years, they're complaining and whining and crying and losing. And they win some World Series, two or three in recent years, and all of a sudden they're, feeling pretty good about themselves. And still, a year in which they come in as the overwhelming favorites in the AL East, and the Yankees, at the moment, a better-run organization with a brighter future and a better current team, and right away they're making comments, you see?
Stephanie's about to pay
They're
her
whining
mind.
And
pretty
complaining.
Mm-hmm. Something about this place that pushes you. You know, there's no off days here in Fenway Park. If you need something to push you that day, well, you look around, and the fans will be here, and they're going to push you to be the best.
J.D. Martinez has signed a five-year, $110 million deal with the Red Sox.
But here's my question. What's J.D. Martinez? What is he? You tell me what he is, because I don't think it's clear.
The issue is they don't have a guy in the middle of the lineup that changes the way opposing pitchers and opposing teams pitch to them.
For those who've been coming to opening days for generations, to those who may be enjoying their first visit, we welcome you.
And then that sets up an epic rematch. Last time the Yankees
played the Red Sox in the postseason, of course, was 2004. Yankees are looking for a little rematch.
Well, being the exceptional baseball analyst that you are, I understand that you're not going to be presumptuous about the Yankees or anybody else. But I am going to. I am going to assume that the Yankees are going to win that one wild card spot. That's what I do. Now, that means that they would eventually go against the Boston Red Sox. Everybody's been raving about Boston, including yourself, A-Rod. Here's my thing. I'm looking at a guy like Price, David Price. 9 postseason starts. 5.74 ERA. I'm looking at Sale. 1 postseason start at ERA over 12. Pitching is what wins World Series championships in my estimation. I understand Boston has been terrific, but with 107 wins to date, is it possible that the pressure might be too much and Boston might not be up to the challenge that everybody's saying they're up to?
There's a tremendous amount of pressure on Boston, no question, going into the postseason.
It sets up for the great rivalry in Major League Baseball in a division series round. Boston against the New York Yankees.
Best home run hitters in the game, J.D. Martinez.
Over and over and over.
And the 2-0 to Martinez.
There's a drive to left field, back by the wall. Is it high enough? Yes! 3-run homer into the first row of the Boston Sea. 3-0 Red Sox.
J.D. Martinez puts the Red Sox on the board. That ball's ripped.
Air ball, home run, and the cycle for Brock Holt. He hits for the cycle in a postseason game. Chris Sale is on the mound. 0-2.
Sale kicks deals.
That's way strike. He got the slider in there. 1-2-3. 8th inning for Chris Sale.
Are 3 outs away from moving on to the American League Championship Series.
Good second, but 1-2. One attempt at the third. Slowly hit. Charging his Nunez as he fires the first. Stretch. Got him! What a play by Pierce! And the Red Sox have won the division series against the Yankees. And the Red Sox are moving on to play the Houston Astros in the American League Championship Series. The Red Sox winning this ballgame 4-3, eliminating the Yankees in 4.
Team, and we know it. We got Houston. Let's go.
Best team in baseball. Yep. I know people are looking at the Red Sox, and they deserve an enormous amount of credit, but I look at the team most likely to go deep into the playoffs, and for me, it's the Houston Astros. It really is.
Swinging a high drive to right field. Ready? Going back. Back to the warning track. This ball is going, and it is gone. A great play.
Tendy dives, and he makes the catch. Oh, what a play. The Red Sox win on a spectacular catch by Benintendi in left field. Wow. What a game. What a finish.
Chip series, the Boston Red Sox will clinch with a win tonight. They lead the series 3-1.
What is his biggest start as a member of the Red Sox? That's the biggest start of his entire career tonight.
Jose Altuve with 2 away in the 6th inning. Can David Price keep it going here? It's a huge story developing, and a swing and a miss. It's his 9th strikeout for David Price. That is a new career postseason high. 6 shutout innings.
believe it.
Like I told them in New York, you know, we have 8 more to go, and now we have 4 more, boys.
It is a classic battle between two very, very classic franchises. World Series Baseball from Fenway Park in Boston. The Red Sox, the champions of the American League, hosting the National League champion Los Angeles Dodgers. Rain, thunder, lightning, that's all gone. But it'll be some chilly temperatures, 53 degrees. And
boy, let me tell you, against one of the most dangerous hitters in baseball, you give him a second chance.
Base hit for Betts, and he's on to start the night for Boston.
Right away, we set the tempo. Let's put pressure on these guys.
There goes Betts.
And a throw down to second gets into center on a steal by Mookie Betts.
Now Kershaw will face his first left-handed batter in the Red Sox lineup, Andrew Benintendi.
Right side, base hit. Here comes Betts. Up throwing. Throw no good. Too high. Down to second, Benintendi. 1-0 Boston in the first.
The Red Sox are knocking Kershaw around early.
With left-hander Alex Wood on, Alex Cora goes to his bench, and Eduardo Nunez will pinch hit.
Alex Cora made a decision to start Devers, even though Kershaw was starting the game, because he didn't want to be so left-handed on the bench, and now he gets the matchup he was looking for.
That is hammered in the left.
Deep by the wall. Gone!
Three-run pitch on Eduardo Nunez. Can you believe it? And the Red Sox lead it 8-4. Of Alex Cora.
You're absolutely right. I mean, Devers has been seeing the ball well all night long, even against the lefty. He goes to Nunez in a three-run bomb.
Greg Kimbrel ready to go now. He's got his sign. The payoff pitch to Justin Turner. Swung on and missed. Strike three. Oh, yeah! An 8-4 win here tonight. Game one belongs to the Red Sox.
Live from Fenway Park in Boston, game two of the World Series.
Swing and a looper to right field, sinking fast, it gets down for a base hit, Mookie scores, here comes Benny, he scores too, on to third base, 4-2 Red Sox. Swinging a hard ground ball to short, Bogarts has it, wings to first, the Red Sox win it, the Red Sox beat the Dodgers 4-2, they go up 2-0 in the 2018 World Series.
3-2. Struck him out. 1-0-1.
Eovaldi threw 6 innings without allowing an earned run. The longest game in World Series history reached the bottom of the 18th, with Eovaldi still on the mound for his 7th inning of relief.
Muncy flies one in the air to left center. Back at the wall, and it's gone! It's over! Muncy! A walk-off home!
Despite the loss in the historic game, the Red Sox were confident heading into Game 4.
91 pitches for Hill. And what a dramatic statement he has made.
Getting pats on the back from all the infielders. And
Now he's making his way to the third base dugout and a standing ovation.
He leaves the Dodgers in pretty good shape to be evened up in this series.
Now I need a miracle.
Just saw between innings, Chris Sale absolutely going crazy in the dugout, screaming and yelling at his teammates, trying to get them going.
Here's Dave Robertson, who comes to third pitcher of the inning. Ryan Madsen takes over. Now Mitch Moreland will come off the bench to hit with two on and two out.
When I need you the most, so don't let me, don't let me, don't let me.
Into the pavilion and right, the 4-3 game.
Well, here you go. Put your seatbelts on. We got two innings, one-run game.
Here is Jansen, who threw 32 pitches last night, charged with a blown save when Jackie offered.
Top four slots in the Red Sox lineup. Last night, 0-28. Tonight, 0-13. So 0-41.
It's a high drive, left center.
They get the big man out of the bullpen trying to close it out, and he has not been able to do it.
And the momentum has shifted back to the visiting side tonight.
Here it is. Swing and a miss. He got him.
For the second straight night, a World Series game was going to the ninth, all tied up.
Red Sox bats ice cold until the seventh inning. Chris Sale's impassioned speech in the dugout woke him up. 1-2 pitch. Holt swings, hits a ground ball. Third base side, that's a fair ball. It's going to roll down toward the corner. Holt around first. He's on his way to second, and he will be in with a pop-up slide and a one-out double to the go-ahead run now in scoring position.
And Holt, who's got great speed, is at second base with one out. Rafael Devers, who turned all of 22 day before yesterday, is going to pinch hit.
This is where Alex Cora wants to win the game, right here.
And a swing and a ground ball up the middle, a base hit. Brock Holt comes around third. He will score. Devers does it again, and the Red Sox come back to lead it. 5-4 in the ninth.
They have come back from being dead in the water, now 4-0. That's been their catchphrase, do damage, and Rafael Devers just did big damage. Bases loaded, two out, with Steve Pierce coming up.
When I was facing Maeda, I was like, the next baseball I connect on, I'm sending 50,000 people home.
Into the gap in right center field. This ball is down into the wall. It will empty the bases. Steve Pierce, what a night. 8-4 Boston in the ninth. Can you believe it? Steve Pierce, acquired in midseason, has become Mr. October in tonight's game. Pitch is swung on and lifted in the air to center field over left center. Benintendi will make the catch, and the Red Sox win it.
The Red Sox stun the Dodgers, come back from a 4-0 deficit.
The Red Sox looked like they were headed for an even series, but they came back with a vengeance.
The Red Sox now have a 3-1 lead and can win the World Series tomorrow night.
There's the little issue of your postseason record.
I think it might surprise people to know that David Price has never won a postseason game that he started.
I think I was just saving all my postseason wins for the Red Sox.
We all know the story. A lot of people
gave up on him.
He's had a chip on his shoulder for quite some time, just dealing with the lack of success at this time of the year.
For him to go out there with 3 days rest in Dodger Stadium, it was a moment.
Quieting critics as he goes through this postseason.
He pitched game two, he pitched in game three, was warming up for game four, and then started game five. That's unheard of for a starter. He stepped up big for us.
Betts has been struggling in the postseason.
High fly ball into left. Back at the wall. It is gone. Betts has made it 3-1. Oh, for his previous 13, and he shoots one out to left.
To give us a three-run lead, then we feel really good.
Back to Price. What a night.
And the Dodgers are retired in order in the bottom of the seventh inning.
Oh, what an outing.
Did Pierce hit another one? Hand him the award. Steve Pierce is in the midst of the best 72 hours of his life.
Sales all alone now in the pen. He's had such a great year, he's had such a great influence on this team. Befitting if he could close a World Series.
He got up on his own, just telling me, I'm in.
That was one of the most special moments of my baseball career. We got three outs to get.
Chris Sale gets the ball for the ninth inning. The Red Sox trying to end it right here.
Obviously, knew I was only throwing one inning, so at that point, you just grip and rip.
A swing and a miss by Turner. And the Dodgers are down to their final two outs tonight.
As soon as you saw the swing, you're like, yep, he's on. This is it. This is about to happen.
The Red Sox are one out away.
No one's talking about it because nobody wants to say it. But we're all sitting there like thinking it. Like, come on, Chris. Come on, Chris.
I threw that pitch with everything I had.
It's over! The Red Sox have won the World Championship!
Oh! And a ball!
Baseball wins it all in 2018.
The Boston Red Sox, baseball's best all season long. They have won it all, and the celebration begins.
This is unbelievable.
Our fans wanted to say to the players, we're here to thank you for the remarkable season you've had, and we're grateful.
It was way more than what I expected. Start over again right now. From Fenway, I'm ready now.
How about next year?
Hell yeah, hell, let's go.
Hell yeah!
Hell yeah! Let's go!
Boy, if the Eagles can come up with their one turnover of the game right
Michael
here.
Michael Jordan, the number six, is a big deal.
If he gets his hands on all six stones.
Brady is sitting on five.
Brady fumbles the football and the Eagles have it! Brady fumbles and Borden.
Launching one for the end zone.
When you don't come through.
And time runs out.
It's
very painful.
There are a lot of people in New England, including guys in that locker room, that want to know why he didn't play Malcolm Butler.
Belichick knew it was time to move off Tom, and it was time to create the next Tom.
We're watching like a soap opera in front of us. The Brady, the Belichick, and the ugly.
Tom Brady, is he going to hit the cliff? Look, there was enough there that I understand why Bill Belichick looked at Tom Brady and said, I want to hang on to Jimmy Garoppolo. Tom Brady didn't like that.
Finally, Jimmy Garoppolo is there for the taking to replace Tom Brady, and he gives him away for a second-round pick, and he gives Jacoby Brissett away for a bust wide receiver. It made no sense.
And the owner picked the 40-year-old quarterback over the coach.
Tom has gotten really, really into Tom lately. Kale pajamas, mattresses that make you sleep like a prince. You know, a lot of Hollywood stuff. Guru.
They lost a left tackle, Nate Solder. He's good. A running back, Deion Lewis. He was special. A wide receiver, Brandon Cooks, on the outside. And a wide receiver on the inside, Danny Amendola. Julian Edelman will be out for a month. Dante Hightower is their only special player in the front seven defensively. They are still searching for a pass rush. They don't have one. That's why Nick Foles beat them.
Mom's not here today. Have you guys spoken at length about...
Yeah, I'm not going to talk about the people that aren't here. The guys that are here are improving. They're working hard.
Brady will not show up to the voluntary OTA.
I think it's a really big deal. You look around the league, there's 31 quarterbacks who are there. Tom Brady has built his reputation on being someone who will outwork.
He already hates the coach. He doesn't want to show up early to work with these OTAs because he doesn't want to see Bill's face because he hates him so much.
We went from Spygate to Deflategate. And now, here comes Breakup Gate.
Dynasties don't last forever.
I don't think they're in trouble. I think they're done. And I don't think you hear that said about the New England Patriots very often, particularly in the Brady Belichick era. When I see Tom Brady making these mistakes, I see somebody trying to overcompensate for what New England's lacking.
The Patriots win the division, but are not dynamic enough on either the offensive or defensive line to be a number one seed.
Brady retreats, pressure by one, and sacked by one.
I'm not one of these guys that likes to sound the alarm, but sound the alarm!
Tannehill throws down the middle, caught by Stills, laterals back to Butler, or rather Parker, who flips it to Drake. He runs across the 40 of New England, angling inside to the 30, 25, 20.
Think about the Chiefs, the Chargers.
But they ain't going to do much in the playoffs because they're not going to win their road game. Stephen A. pointed it out. They have three losses now all on the road. And by the way, Tom Brady has a wet noodle for an arm right now. Say what it is.
They are not going back to the Super Bowl. That's my standard for saying that it is over. They are not going back to the Super Bowl.
The main culprit of their concern should be number 12. Those licks hurt more. Mm-hmm. And you didn't want to feel those licks.
Tom Brady can't drive the ball like he once could. He's flinching. If you think for 1 second Tom Brady's going to play till he's 45, you're foolish.
Josh Gordon is no longer a New England Patriot. This ends New England's Super Bowl threat. It's over. It is officially over.
Are we witnessing the end of the Patriots' dynasty?
Part of the journey is the end.
I know you're crying on the inside, but you fake it to make it. Gotta hold on. You gotta have the patience and believe you're gonna make it. Gotta hold on. I know you're tired of surviving, but you gotta keep on trying. Gotta hold on. Hold on. You gotta have the patience and believe you're gonna make it. Gotta hold on. I know you're tired of surviving, but you gotta keep on trying. Gotta hold on.
Gotta have the patience, and believe you're gonna make it. Gotta hold on. I danced with the darkness till I found a light. Yeah. Shape of a woman, she the love of my life. Keeps my head up high, she gives me all that I need. Picks me right up when I'm down on my knees. patience and believe you're gonna make it. Gotta hold on. I know you're tired of surviving, but you gotta keep on trying. Gotta hold on. Hold on.
I want no parts of this conversation.
Hasn't been himself of late. Let me give you some numbers. In his last three games against the Bills, Packers, and Titans, his completion percentage is under 60. He's only thrown one touchdown. His QBR is 41.5.
Falling off the cliff does not mean you can never have a good game.
Yeah.
It means you're not the same anymore. It means that your status as the best in the game or one of the two best in the game is no longer there.
Dread it. Run from it. Destiny still arrives.
We all want it!
Championship game, and it's a rematch against Kansas City, this time though in Arrowhead. What can we expect from that one?
It'll be a good game. They're a good team, and we played them earlier this year. I know everyone thinks we suck and can't win any games, so we'll see. It'll be fun.
Tom Brady is the most feared player in the National Football League.
And Belichick also knows, and New England also knows, they're in big trouble. They cannot now, without a deep threat, beat Kansas City, beat Pittsburgh.
Finds a time for Brady to go for it. To the end zone, and it's caught for the touchdown. Philip Dorsett.
Nice, the ball. Nice, the ball.
Thanks, baby. Thanks, baby.
Stick with
thanks, baby.
Good job.
Way to go, Hawks.
Good job, fellas.
You're too.
No. You're too old.
I had no doubt.
That's not true.
Yes, it was. I had no doubt that Tom Brady was going to win that game when they got the ball.
T-side his tails, helmet his heads, T-side his tails. New England again. You're the visiting team. It's your choice.
Heads.
Heads.
Heads is the call.
It is heads.
You want the ball.
Matthew Slater makes that very clear.
We want the ball. There have been other great quarterbacks. There have been other great quarterbacks to have great moments. But I don't believe there's been a quarterback that can call upon his greatness time after time when they needed the most.
It's over. This is a whole new game right now. The adjustments have taken place. You've seen what the opponent has done successfully throughout the game. Now, right here, I'd do the same thing. I'd be aggressive right from the way.
And when they needed it the most, when he needs to be absolutely great, he can do it.
Time of Super Bowl 51.
Yeah, Tom Brady looked at Pat Mahomes and said, you're going to have to pry this from my cold, dead fingers, right? And that's exactly what happened.
Here we go.
To deny this level of greatness at this point in time, it reflects on you, not him.
Running back's got to help, so he has time to throw. Once again, Edelman in the middle of the field.
Pocket sealed. Down the middle. Edelman again with a third down catch. Third and 10. Ball at the Chiefs 30.
Gronk is out wide. Watch the top of your screen. Watch this safety. If he comes down, there's a good chance he's throwing out there.
It's Gronk for the first down.
So much for Gronk being washed up and done. And I think Gronk, just like Tom Brady all year long, battling injuries, some of which we knew about, some of which we didn't.
You can see the defenders for Kansas City. They're exhausted over there.
You have the young gun, Patrick Mahomes, 23 years old, and then you have the old guard, Tom Brady, 41 years old, and this torch that Brady just refused to let go.
I can't see it here. This has to be a run.
Second and goal to Burkhead. Burkhead to the end zone. Hello, Super Bowl. New England is heading back again for the third straight year.
America's worst nightmare is back.
With Vince Lombardi and George Halas with five titles as head coach if the Patriots win Super Bowl 53. Bill Belichick will stand alone with the most championships by a head coach in NFL history.
I actually think he's the greatest football player of all time. I think he's passed Jim Brown, Jerry Rice, Lawrence Taylor, and Montana. Really, at this point, it's about chasing the ultimate level of team sport greatness in this country, and that's Michael Jordan.
Brady walked into the facility and said, and I quote, I am the baddest mother on the planet.
Think about this is one last time. When I was reading a verse in Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verse 9 and 10, it says two is better for one, but they have a great reward. Because if one falls, the other one can pick them up. The other one can pick them up. What was the man who's alone? Because no one can pick him up. All day today, fellas, have each other's back. One last time. One last time for the 2018 season. We've been through everything to be here in this moment, for everyone back home, for your mom, your dad, your grandparents, everyone that loves you. Tonight is the night. Show the world. Dominate on three. One, two, three.
Here we go.
Super Bowl. Let's have a day, Jim.
All right.
Belichick's Patriots shut down the next generation Rams the old-fashioned way. Outworking them.
Listen, it's over for New England.
Does it feel like the beginning of the end for the Patriots dynasty?
It really does. And I think a lot of that's predicated. Tom is 41. Tom is not the same player that he once was.
Edelman clearly doesn't look the same.
Rob Gronkowski ain't the same.
Bill Belichick's not great.
And Brady was being stifled back there.
But if you make yourself more than just a man, if you devote yourself to an ideal, and if they can't stop you, then you become something else entirely.
Which is...
legend.
Leadership, perseverance, determination, work ethic, discipline. I want to be the best I can be. I know when I go out there, it's not to compare myself to this guy or that guy. It's everyone's good. Everyone plays good. I still feel like there's still more to be accomplished. I was practicing the last 2 days, like, you know, working on my technique, on my fundamentals, on my all the things with my training that I still feel like I can be better. Be a percentage better.
Edelman is killing whoever's on him.
If you happen to be very lucky, when you're 10 years old, you'll have people in your life who tell you the world is anything you want it to be, and you'll believe them. And those people will never put limits on your abilities. In return, no matter the circumstances, you always try best and you never give up, because that's what you do when you're chasing your dream. If you're lucky, you'll have family, teammates, coaches, mentors, and trainers along the way to help you when you lose faith in yourself. And they'll give you the strength to carry on. If you're lucky, you may get picked last. You may ride the bench, and many times the team may move on without you. And you come to recognize that in return, you're given the chance to earn the greatest edge of all, and one that can never be taken away. Will, heart. So to anyone who feels left out or is afraid of trying their best for fear of failure, you're not alone. The magic you're looking for is in the will of trying and not giving up. The love of your dream is in your heart. One day you'll look back on your life and appreciate the struggle and have nothing but gratitude for everything that happened along the way. To anyone who's struggling early in the morning or late at night in pursuit of your dream, struggles that many will never see, and to any leaders out there who believe in someone who doesn't yet believe in themselves, keep going. Keep going. Because will always finds a way.
He's been a quarterback that can call upon his greatness time after time when they need it the most. And when they needed it the most, when he needs to be absolutely great, he can do it.
Your reign is over.
4 for 4, 67 yards.
My reign has just begun.
Makes the catch over two defenders, tumbling to the two.
It just sounds happy. I just told you they're gonna bleed him. He's gonna dink. He's gonna dunk you. He's gonna set
guys,
you up.
Guys, this is something that we're probably never gonna see again in our lifetime.
It's a 29-yard strike.
You should have learned. I should have learned. We all should have learned.
Running it for the touchdown.
But it's fourth quarter and it's money time for the greatest guy to ever suit it up. Give him the ball when the game's on the line. Tie game. Cool as a cucumber.
There it is. The dynasty continues.
It was his 13th game winning drive in the playoff. No other quarterback has more than six.
Sixth Super Bowl title. In the early 2000s, they won 3 of 4. Now they have won 3 of the last 5. Yes, it's still a dynasty.
Six-time world champion. And there ain't nothing you can do about it.
But there is one constant throughout this whole 18 years. Bill Belichick and Tom Brady.
Had the same goals in mind for 19 years and the greatest coach of all time. And we just had some incredible moments together.
No quarterback I'd rather have than Tom Brady.
This is as good as it gets right here.
We've been here before. The confetti. The hugs and kisses. That familiar pose. It's all so 2016, and 2014, and 2004, and 2003. And oh brother, what is it about this dynasty that it won't die?
You know what my favorite ring is? The next one.
Now that's what I think. The next one.
I'm gonna tell you a story. I'm gonna tell you about